Hello and welcome back to the second module of satellite communication lecture series, wherein we are talking about the satellite subsystem. And in the last lecture, we started off with the communication subsystem, which includes two things. One, the transponder, and the second one is satellite antennas. So in the last lecture, we talked about transponder, and in this lecture, we are going to talk about the satellite antennas. So satellite antennas play a very, very important role as far as the communication is concerned, because this is the part of that whole system which is actually going to radiate or transform the energy which was till now in the form of electrical currents or voltage into electromagnetic waves. It plays a very, very important role in that sense. So how we are going to select which antennas we should use? Before that, we need to know what are the different antenna parameters that we have to understand about the antenna before selecting the correct one. So there are different parameters like antenna pattern, gain, and the beam width. So what is antenna pattern? So in this figure, it is quite clearly explained or drawn. Like if you see in this diagram, the polar plot has been drawn, where if you move in the clockwise direction, the angle is moving from 0 degree till 360 degree. So 0 to 90, then 180 and 270 degree. The plot that is being drawn here is of the radiation pattern. That means the electric field is drawn here. I mean, the square of electric field is basically drawn here. And if by just seeing, okay, I'll just show you this. So if you see this side, this is basically the main lobe, and this gives us the maximum peak over here at 0 degree. We have our side lobes also here. These are the side lobes which exist in the direction starting from this angle till this angle. We have a back lobe also, which has a power which is more than the side lobes here. So it's very important to understand this antenna pattern, because this is the parameter which is going to actually help us to decide which antenna we are basically going to use in the communication. And this, again, if you see the main lobe here, the width of this, I mean, how broad this width is coming out, that will be given by the parameter which is known as the beam width. And the second parameter that we are seeing here is the gain. And gain is basically the power radiated, the maximum power radiated in any direction compared to the average power that is radiated overall. So that gives us the gain. So basically, by just seeing, with just having a view of this antenna pattern that is drawn here, we can say that the gain is maximum in this direction, that is zero. If we go into the details of gain, there are again two types of gain: the power gain and the directive gain, or the directivity that we call. So there are various parameters that we can go in detail while we are studying in antennas, but for now, what is important for us is the antenna parameters that is going to play role while we are selecting a specific antenna, depending upon what kind of pattern we want, what kind of coverage area we have. So parameters are antenna pattern, gain, and the beam width. Now, how do we estimate gain and beam width? So here the formula that is given, it is a general, the formula is actually for the aperture type of antenna, and this particular formula, it is related direct. If you see the formula, gain is directly proportional to the area. So that we know, if the area of the antenna is large, that means it is going to provide us a high gain, which is generally expected at the satellite. So if, and from this particular expression, we can also, it is quite clearly visible that if lambda is very, very small, which will happen in the case when f is very, very high. So f is high, lambda is small, that gain turns out to be very high. So there are many reasons of selecting a high frequency when we are dealing with the antenna, satellite and all. Then obviously one of the reason for going into the high frequency or advantage of going into the high frequency is that we are getting a high gain, we are getting a very spot pencil beam, the beam width also that we can see here in the next formula that we have. The 3 dB beam width is given by 75 lambda by d, where lambda is actually the wavelength, and if f is high, lambda is small, that will gives us the beam width to be small. That means it will be more like directional, in a direction the width will be small. So if you see here, the diagram actually explains. So this is similar to what we saw in the earlier slide, the last slide, where we talked about the antenna pattern. The same has been given here, but here the emphasis has been given on the half power point, with the help of which we are calculating the beam width. So if you see the main lobe, most of the time the value of the direction, the gain and antenna patterns are basically drawn with the normalized power. So that is the reason why, if you see here in the main lobe maximum direction, this value is given to be 1. So normalized value is 1, that is maximum power, whatever is there is divided. So this direction, which is getting the maximum power, is divided by the maximum power. So this will give the value 1. So that is a normalized value. So if you go beyond, in both the directions, beyond this angle, so if you go this side or you go this side, you can see the decrease in the power of the antenna, the power radiated by the antenna. So as we have already seen in different subjects where we talked about, in like especially in the case of filters, where we talk about 3 dB bandwidth. So here on the similar grounds, here we are talking about 3 dB beam width. This is the point where the power goes half the value at the maximum point. So if you see here, the value is like the maximum. So the point at which it becomes half of this value, that is because here it is the drawn values are normalized values, here it is coming to be 0.5. so these are the two points where the power is going to become becoming half of the maximum, that is 0.5. so this line has been drawn here, and this, the difference between the two angles, so the angle is calculated, and this angle is basically known as the beam width. Hope you understand the beam widths here. So there are half power point at the right and left, and then we have calculated the beam width. So here, if you see the for antennas, you'll come back here, the 3 dB theta 3 dB approximately equals to, so as we know, these formula that has been given are the generalized formulas and are approximate ones. These are not the accurate formulas. So when we go into one specific antenna, this particular formula will obviously, we'll have to deal with the specific, the formulas of that specific antenna. But in general, these are the formula. The relation remains the same. There might be some difference in the value, how is it related, but the relation here will remain same. Like for example, here we are saying in gain, that gain is directly proportional to the area of the antenna, that will remain same. And again, it is dependent upon the inversely proportional on the lambda, that also will remain same. So this particular formula that we are seeing is basically off aperture antenna, and eta A that you see here is the aperture efficiency. So it's not that easy for us to calculate aperture efficiency, but in general it lies in the range of 55 to 70 degree, where reflector antennas with single feed. So there is, we will definitely talk about the reflector antenna, but for now what we understand by eta A, it is the aperture efficiency. So aperture efficiency may vary depending upon the different types of antennas and different types of the feeds also. If suppose there is a reflector type antenna, and the shape of the reflector is paraboloid, and if the horn is the feet, then it is possible that the aperture efficiency might change if we are having a single feet or we are having a double feet. So if there is double feet, then in that case aperture efficiency decreases. Horn antennas again have higher efficiencies than reflector antennas, typically in the range of 65% and 80%. So we can see here that this aperture efficiency is basically dependent upon the type of antennas we are using. So now we have given the relation between gain and the beam width directly. So if beam width is small, then gain is high, and if the beam width is high, then gain is low. And this particular formula that we have stated here in this we have taken 33,000 value, which is a constant, and this value of 33,000 is a typical value for reflector type antenna, which is used for the satellite communication. Now with this, we will try to understand this diagram. So this is basically contours of circular spot beam serving Western Europe from a satellite located at 8 degree east. What do you mean by this? So if you see that this diagram, 8 degree east has been located somewhere in between the contour. So this contour that has been drawn is basically the power pattern has been drawn in the shape of contours, which is as we move away from the satellite, the value of the power that is received at those points decreases. And what is the relation between the power that is we are getting at different places, that has been drawn here. So if you see, 8 degree east is the point of this satellite location, and where minus 1 has been written, it is minus 1 dB. So 8 degree east is basically 0 dB. So the dB values on the contours are relative to the maximum gain of the antenna, which is set to 0 dB. So here, as you move away, the values are decreasing. So if you see minus 1, that is minus 1 dB. It is minus 1 from the maximum value. Again, minus 2, minus 3, 4, and so on and so forth. So as we go away from the satellite, what happens? That is what is expected. As we go beyond away from the point, what will happen to the power? It will obviously decrease. The center of the beam is in Western Germany. The contours are spread out to the northern latitude by the curvature of the earth. So now why they have called it the northern latitude? Because if you see here in this diagram, the x-axis represents the longitude and the y-axis represents the latitude. And in the latitude, it has been mentioned here 40, 50, 60 and 70. And obviously these values will come in the northern direction. The contours can also be specified in EIRP. So here we have drawn this contours with based on the power levels, but the same can be drawn in the with the help of EIRP, which is effective isotropically radiated power. So that can also be drawn. So it depends. So basically the sense is same. We want to just know as to what will be the power that is being radiated by the antenna, received by the antenna at different places as we go away from the center. The EIRP, what is the EIRP? It is the product of transmitted power and the antenna gain, usually quoted on dBW, that is decibels greater than 1 watt. So now we will move on to the next slide. Now the typical satellite antenna patterns and coverage zones. So here we are trying to get into the different patterns that these satellite antennas might produce. So we can see here global beams, spot beams, multiple spot beams and scanning beams. Then we have orthogonally polarized beams. We can see here in the first global beam diagram that the global beam is 17 degree wide and can be generated with the help of a horn antenna. So basically our choice of antenna will definitely depend upon what kind of beam width it is producing. So this particular horn antenna produces a wider beam, and here we can see that global beam of 17 degree, which global beam of 17 degree means it is going to cover the whole earth. So that kind of wide beam can be generated with the help of horn antenna only. Spot beams, which is like covering a smaller area, And as we discussed earlier that in case we go in higher in frequency, the beam width of the antenna decreases, and that which that allows us to use that antenna as a spot beam antenna. So spot beam requires reflector antennas, and multiple spot beams need a reflector with a multiple feed. So it is possible that we have a single reflector, but with more than one feed in that case. So, and it is possible to provide horn antenna as a feed to a reflector. So that will tend to increase our gain, and there are various other benefits of also of using a reflector type antenna. So scanning beams typically are generated with a phased array antenna. So there is possibility that, again, we'll talk about in later slides, but here to just give an insight, phased array antenna are basically used to generate like scanning beams. So it can actually move from one angle to another angle depending upon the excitation that we are providing to that particular antenna. So we have orthogonally polarized, and you can see that in the diagram too. So in this particular diagram, it is pretty clear that this is being provided by the phased array antenna, and there are multiple spot beams, scanning beams are there. So it is, we are able to steer the beams in that case. So, so orthogonally polarized beams using V and H linear polarization, or left hand and right hand circular polarizations, can overlap. So, as we have talked about this in the last lecture, that it is possible to utilize the same frequency. That means we can do frequency reuse so that we can increase our bandwidth capacity by using the same frequency. So here, by using same frequency, one with the two different orthogonal polarization. So if you're doing vertical and horizontal polarization, so in that specific same type, we can utilize it to send two types of signals, and that is that allows us to for having frequency reuse. So that can also, that is actually shown in the last diagram that we have. Moving ahead now. Now we will talk about the satellite antennas. What are the different types of antennas available? And which is, this is not just the types of antennas available, these are the types which are we are using in the satellites. So we have wire antennas, which are monopoles and dipoles. We have horn antennas, then we have reflector antennas and phased array antennas. So these are the general antennas that we used, that we use in the satellite. So we'll start with the wire antenna just to have a glimpse of what it is, because in detail we can study in antennas, but here we are just studying as to what are the different types of antennas which are being used in the satellite. So wire antennas, we have monopoles and dipoles. How does monopole look like? You can see here, monopole is basically an antenna which is of size lambda by 4. So here we can see that if we are talking of like higher values of F, then obviously these antenna size will come out to be very, very small. In fact, if you generally talk about antennas, for effective radiation by an antenna, it is required to have the size of the antenna is required to have in its range of lambda. So anyhow, if F is increased, the size of the antennas decrease. So we can have that picture clear by the values. Like if you are making an antenna at 4 gigahertz, the value comes out to be near around 11.3 meters, whereas in the case of 30 gigahertz antenna, the size of the antenna comes out to be 1.5 meters. So it's, just think of it, 11.3 meters, which was pretty very difficult for us to make an antenna of this size at home. Now when we are receiving the satellite broadcasting, the TV services directly at home, the size of the antenna is very, very small. It is around 31.5 meters. So obviously we are able to decrease the size of the antenna by just sending the signals at a very, very high frequencies. So this is the monopole, which is of the size of lambda by 4. In this condition is, we need to have a conductive ground that we can see here. In this case, if you see, yeah, so if you see here, we have a conductive ground. So this is the conductive ground, and the feed is coming here, and this is the antenna, this is the radiating part, which is of size lambda by 4. Then we have half wavelength, this is dipole, and dipole antenna, which is half wavelength, this is lambda by 4, and this one again is lambda by 4, which combines to give us this size, which is lambda by 2. So this is this whole size of dipole antenna is half wavelength. Okay, so horn antenna. So horn antenna, this horn antenna is basically a flared section of a waveguide that provides an aperture several wavelengths wide and good match between a waveguide impedance and a free space. So this is the antenna which is very, very much used here. So if you see in this diagram, the upper one here, this diagram has the feed of horn antenna. And this we can see at our home when we are receiving with the help of DTH, direct to home services, the antennas that we have at home, that too has a feed horn. So that is actually covered, so we are not able to see exact horn there. Now horn antennas are used at microwave frequencies when relatively wide beams are required. So as I said, the choice of antenna depends upon the type of application wherein it is used. And this is used, generally it is used at microwave when the wider beams are required and for global coverage. Horns are also used as feed for reflectors, as I said. So either singly or in clusters. So it can be utilized, the horn antennas can be used as a single horn, a single feed to a reflector antenna, or in clusters also it can be used. So horn and reflectors are examples of aperture antennas that launch a wave into free space from waveguide. It is difficult to obtain gains much greater than 23 dB or beam width narrower than 10 with the horn antennas. So as I said, there is pros and cons of each and every antenna that we are using here. So depending upon the application we choose. So here it says that it's very difficult to provide a very high gain, more than 23 dB. So in that case, we are going to use reflector antennas. So for a higher gains and narrow bandwidth. So the horn cannot provide narrow beams. So for the case when we want spot beams, spot beam antenna, obviously we cannot use horn in that case. So for higher gains and narrow beam widths, we will use a reflector antenna or array. Array can also be used in that case. So horn antennas tend to have higher efficiencies than reflector antennas, typically of range between 65% to 80%. And obviously we talked about that aperture efficiency. And yeah, this is general efficiency also, but we know that aperture efficiency also we calculated there. So now we come across the reflector antennas. So reflector antennas are usually illuminated by one or more horns and provide a large aperture that can be achieved with the horn alone. For maximum gain, it is necessary to generate a plane wave in the aperture of the reflector. So these details we can talk about an antenna, but now for instance, for this particularly for satellite antennas that we are studying, what is important for us is the diagram that we see here is the reflector, and we have a feed for that reflector, and that feed is generally it needs to be placed at the focus of the curvature we have. So this is achieved by what we have, the waves are coming parallelly, the plane waves come in parallel, and that gets reflected by the curvature of the reflector antenna, and it is reflected and it is converged at the focus. And here at the focus only we have a horn antenna here, and that was going to receive the signal and then convert it into the signals, whatever it is. So here we can see this is achieved by choosing a reflector profile that has equal path lengths from the feed to the aperture, so that all energy radiated by the feed and reflected by the reflector reaches the aperture with the same phase angle and creates a uniform phase front. So we have understood what reflector antenna is, and the shape of the antenna, paraboloid, is the basic shape of the most reflector antenna and is most commonly used in the earth station antenna. So if you see here at home also, when we are receiving the direct in the case of direct to home services, we are receiving signals with the help of a reflector type antenna which has a horn on its feed. So I will just show you that example here. So this antenna, if you see here, this is a kind of DTH only, and this diagram we have single horn and triple horn also. So here you see this is the horn, the feed of the antenna. And again here also we can see this is triple feed. So this is like, if you see the antennas at home, there is a cover over the horn. So here this is the horn over which this cover is actually put. So this white one that you see is the cover, and this horn over that horn we have a cover. That is why we are not able to see the exact horn that we have. So so we have the idea of horn antenna. Now moving ahead, we have phased array antenna. So what is phased array antenna? This is basically the array of antenna which is actually there are the feeds are given, I mean the excitation is given to individual antennas. So an antenna array is a set of two or more antennas. The signals from the antenna are combined or processed in order to achieve improved performance over that of a single antenna. So basically, if sometimes we are not able to generate certain pattern with the help of a single antenna, in that case we use an array of antenna. So in the first diagram, as you can see, this particular array of antenna is able to generate in the specific direction, that is at an angle of theta. So this pattern is directed towards the angle theta in this case, and this angle theta can be changed. How can it be changed? It can be changed by changing the value of this angle. So if you see here, this theta is somehow, so there are two places where theta is written. One is here, this value. So here theta is written, and here also theta is written. So why it is intentionally written here? Reason being is, if you change some here, the controller is there, and if you change the value of theta here, then this beam will steer. So this beam can be changed, the direction in which the maximum value is coming, that can be changed with the help of this angle only. So that same thing I just tried to explain the next figure also. If you see, the feed network is there, and there is basically in the, you must have studied somewhere in the antenna, there are two types of beam basically. Which is getting generated by an array of antenna. One is the broadside array, and another one is the end fire array. So if the angle this side, if it is coming along this perpendicular direction, then this is broadside, and this here I will show you this. So if it is coming in this direction, it is broadside, and if it is cutting in this direction, the maximum gain is coming in this direction, it is end fire. So, and this can again be changed, this angle can be, so if you see beam tilted, how is this beam tilted? It is tilted by the input angle, that is we have the phase shift that we are providing in the input part. So if we change that, and if the excitation of individual elements are changed, then what will happen to the antenna pattern? The maximum direction of the maximum power will actually change, and that is what we can see from the radiation pattern that has been drawn here. So here if you see in this direction the maximum value is coming, here if you see in this direction, so this change has occurred because the input that we provided, so we have changed the input phase shift, and that is the reason why the output also has steered, it has changed, and this beam has tilted. So I hope you were able to understand. So then in nutshell, we have just tried to explain as to what are the different types of antennas that we use in satellites. So the different types of antenna that we saw were wire antennas, horn antennas, then we talked about reflector antennas and phased array antennas. These are typically used in the satellites depending upon the applications. Whether we want to generate a global coverage, or we want to generate a spot beam, or we want to basically steer the beam or change the beam. So accordingly, we will actually choose the different types of antenna that we have studied. So with this, we come to the end of the second module, which was satellite subsystems, in which we talked about AOCS, TTCNM, and power systems. communication subsystems, and communication subsystem we talked about transponders and satellite antennas. Thanks a lot for watching.